Okay, good morning. Thank you for turning up. There's a 5 minute disconnect between this clock and that clock. By my cell phone, that clock is right, and that's the one I can see. So I'm going to go by that one, if you'll excuse me. But this one, as I say, is 5 minutes out from my cell phone anyway. Yeah, I don't know if that's for you. Is that for you as well? Yeah, okay, thanks. Okay, before I start off, do you have any questions about anything? Great. So we're talking about viral zoonoses. That's things that we get from other animals. Yesterday we talked about ones that we get via insect vectors that carry them between other animals and us. Today we're talking about them where we get them from direct contact. And the biggie here is rabies. Hopefully you will never see a case of rabies in your lifetime. It's many years since we had a case of rabies in South Carolina, many, many years. But that's because of constant surveillance. So you're going to be treating people to prevent rabies quite, well, I don't know how frequently, but you stand a very finite chance of doing that because we get quite a few rabies treatments in South Carolina every year. So this is a disease that is far more important for you to prevent, and hopefully you will never see it. Worldwide, there are about 55,000 deaths from rabies a year, and it's a very, very nasty death. This is the virus with the highest case fatality that we know of. So virtually everybody who gets clinical symptoms dies. So it's really a very nasty disease once you get it, and it's a very unpleasant death once you get it. I will come back to this later on, but this is a case presentation and I've highlighted some things. And so when you go through this, I hope that when you look at this slide later on, you'll see why I highlighted them. But I get on with the rest of the lecture first. So it's rabies virus. We've already discussed the life cycle of rabies. It's an RNA virus and it's enveloped. So is it going to be relatively easy to inactivate with soap and water? Yeah. Where's it going to grow? Where's it going to replicate its RNA? In the cytoplasm, yeah. And that's going to, both of those are going to become important as we go through it. This was done for kids, and it's called NerveMan. So CDC had this NerveMan. And I like it because I think it tells you a lot about rabies in a very easy way. And one reason that CDC does have a lot of rabies for kids is because kids are usually the ones who have to get vaccinated against it in this country, and so it sort of gives them something that they can look at. But anyway, the point is here, you're bitten here, the virus goes up the nerves to the brain, and then when it gets to the brain, it spreads down the nerves back out to the periphery. It doesn't go through the blood. So blood is not infectious, it doesn't go through the blood, it goes through the nerves, and the problem is that but the symptoms are once it reaches the central nervous system. You don't get antibody until it reaches the central nervous system, and you don't get infectious until it reaches the central nervous system, because you get infectious once it starts spreading out. So it's confined, it gets up via the nerves. How is it transmitted? The usual route is it's transmitted by the bite of a rabid animal. But it can also be transmitted by surgeons, by a corneal and other transplants. And this is part of the reason why there is this long list of questions that are asked when people donate things for transplants, because there have been occasions where people have actually been transplant donors without it being realised that what they died of was rabies. So it's one of these things that there's now very careful screening. It can be also transmitted if rabies-infected liquids get in direct contact with mucosal membranes or with a wound so that the virus can get quickly in. Remember, this is an envelope virus. It's not stable that long once it gets out of its nice warm environment in saliva and so on. Or not so necessary, warmth isn't necessary, but it's a good fluid for it. Once it's on hard surfaces, it has a problem. And it can't penetrate unless it gets in via a wound or via infecting mucosal membranes. And it can It can be transmitted by aerosols, but that's very rare, so it's not a likely transmission. It's probably only going to occur in lab workers if it occurs in this country, because only lab workers are likely to be exposed to a sufficiently high concentration. But any lab worker who's working with rabies should be thoroughly vaccinated. So. Okay, this is Nerve Man made respectable for a textbook, and I don't think you get the message quite as quickly, but it's the same message. The virus is inoculated somewhere or other. If you're lucky, it's far away from the CNS, because the further away it is, the longer it takes for symptoms to develop and the more time you have to do something. So it's it replicates locally in the muscle, and eventually it gets into the sensory nerves. It then goes up the sensory nerves to the dorsal ganglion and enters the central nervous system and up to the brain. It takes a while to do this. The replication down here is not terribly rapid. The speed at which it enters peripheral nerves is not terribly rapid. If you're bitten in somewhere with a higher concentration of sensory nerves, then you've got more of a risk factor. If it's closer to the brain, more of a risk factor for rapid development of disease. So fingers, face are not such good news. Then in the legs, it's going to take a time. And that's going to be important because, as I say, you can deal with this. Because if you raise an antibody response before it gets beyond the blood-brain barrier, then you can stop it in its tracks. So this is a case where antibody can be protective. And you've got time, since it's a slow virus, you have time to actually treat and raise an antibody response so that you stop it getting into the place where it's safe, which is beyond the blood-brain barrier. So if you can get it while it's down here, you can protect the person. So there's post-exposure prophylaxis, and that's where the importance is medically in this country. So I guess this sort of shows a valve. Once it replicates in the dorsal ganglion, it gets beyond our ability. It gets then quite rapidly up to the brain. This bit is quite quick. And then it comes out, and the places where it appears first are the places with the shortest, closest to the brain. So the cornea, the salivary glands, the nerve glands at the base of the neck, the base of hairs at the back of the neck, they're very well innervated, and it can get there very quickly. So it's a question of length of travel. So then you, as I say, once it gets to the brain and replicates in the brain and then spreads out, then these body fluids, or body fluids up here, start to be infectious. And gradually it will spread out everywhere if it's got the chance. But as I say, this virus is lethal fairly quickly once it gets to the brain. But do note, no viremia. So the incubation period is extremely variable. And as I say, that depends on the amount that's put in the wound, where the wound is, how soon it manages to get into the peripheral nerves, etc., etc. But it's between a couple of weeks and a year and a half. And these are, again, vague things. But the important thing here is it's long enough to raise an antibody response. So the average is somewhere about 2 months. And the important thing, as I say, is post-exposure prophylaxis, which we'll come back to in a minute. It's actually quite difficult to diagnose. People can present with typical rabies. If you know about rabies, you say, this looks like rabies. But the problem is, a lot of other things also look like rabies. So it gets to be very difficult. So what you sometimes get, or frequently get, is some kind of abnormal sensation at the site of the bite, because those nerves are being damaged by the virus. You get fever, headache, malaise, anorexia. This is, again, the sort of standard antiviral response. And then as it gets to the brain, of course, and starts doing damage in the brain, you get nausea, vomiting, myalgia, hydrophobia. It causes a lot of problems. Confusion, hallucinations, seizure, paralysis. So you can get so-called dumb rabies, where there's paralysis and the patient is comatose, doesn't respond. You can also get furious rabies, where the patient is aggressive because it's just they don't know what's going on, they've got abnormal mentation. It's very difficult to have a single you don't have a single presentation for this. And there's other reasons why people come into the emergency room with these sort of problems, so it gets to be very difficult. So frequently these people are sent home with anorexia, with recommendation for psychiatric evaluation or something like this, and then they die and then people realise what it is. So it's often diagnosed post-mortem, which creates its own problems, as we'll come to in a minute. But eventually there's coma, respiratory failure and death. And of all the people who've ever been treated with rabies, and lots of treatments have been tried, just one person who did not receive post-exposure prophylaxis has survived. And that person, and there's possibly one more person just this year that may have survived with the same treatment. But that treatment has actually been tried many times since this first person survived, with relatively little success. So it's virtually untreatable. So how do you diagnose it? You diagnose it because of neutralizing antibodies in the serum, but those neutralizing antibodies are not made until it's got to the brain. So by the time you get neutralizing antibodies, it's too late. So actually, the presence of neutralizing antibodies is bad news. There's almost nothing you can do if you find the neutralizing antibodies. But it does confirm the diagnosis. You can also use direct fluorescently labeled antibodies on sections of various things. And as I say, because it gets out quite rapidly to these nerves at the ends, at the base of hairs at the back of the neck, a nuchal biopsy, neck biopsy, or a brain biopsy, but you don't usually do brain biopsies. So the nuchal biopsy can reveal the virus in the nerve cells. You can also use RT-PCR on saliva. I said it again, it gets back down to the salivary glands and then it's secreted in the saliva, so you can use RT-PCR. This is very nice because it's so sensitive, so you don't need a huge amount of virus to do it. Frequently, if you suspect it, you will try more than one of these. And there's post-mortem staining of the brain slice for something called Negri bodies. This is now not routinely used. We've got much better methods to actually detect rabies if we suspect rabies, much more specific and direct methods. You don't necessarily see Negri bodies in every case of rabies. And I'll show you a picture of them at the moment, but they're cytoplasmic inclusions. This is a cytoplasmic virus, remember, so you get cytoplasmic inclusions. You can sometimes get something that looks like a Negri body and you don't have rabies. So it requires people who are used to looking at these things to spot the Negri bodies, definitely, and they're not that diagnostic. But if you have somebody who dies and you don't know what they're dying of and you're doing a post-mortem, the thing is these stain with the regular stains like Giemser, H&E, etc. So what the pathologist does, if they see these when they're looking at the brain and it's an unexplained cause, it immediately raises a red flag that this patient may have had rabies. So the Negri bodies are probably more important these days in detection of unsuspected cases. So this is just to show fluorescent antibody. This is a positive, this is a negative control. These are the Negri bodies. So here's the neuronal cell, the nerve cell, with the cytoplasmic inclusion body. This is just a control with no cytoplasmic inclusion body. Particular cells tend to show these more than others. So pathologists know where in the brain to look and which type of nerve cells to look in. And if you look close up, they tend to have granules inside them. So they can be, as I say, they can be useful if you don't know what somebody died of, and you, even if you haven't suspected rabies, seeing these kind of things are a giveaway as a rule. So what about the epidemiology of rabies? This is single serotype worldwide. So the vaccine works wherever you are. So you don't have to relate that to country of origin or genotype or serotype. It works wherever you are. And worldwide, most cases of rabies are due to canine rabies. So it's dogs, foxes, wolves, coyotes, members of the dog family. But in this country, we rarely see dog-associated rabies. we much more frequently see bat-associated rabies. So in this country, recently, 75% of the cases of rabies have been bat-associated. And part of the reason for that is it's not so much that bats are heavily rabid versus dogs are not. But one thing is our domestic animals are frequently vaccinated against rabies, and that gives us protection against them getting rabies and transferring it to us. Secondly, there are attempts to reduce the rabid the population of rabid animals. Thirdly, if people are mauled by a dog or a raccoon or a skunk, one thing is that bite is going to need medical treatment anyway, so they're going to go and see a physician even if they didn't even think about rabies. But secondly, if a dog or a cat or a raccoon or a skunk or something like that really mauls you, you think that this animal is behaving a bit weirdly and you will probably think of rabies, and your physician should certainly think of rabies. So that's the problem. With bats, bats have very sharp teeth, and even if they give you a bite, it's a minor bite. And so it's probably the sort of thing you'll just wash off with soap and water and not bother to go and see a physician unless you know about rabies being carried by bats. So you have to be kind of careful about the bats, and that's the part of the problem. Most bats are not rabid, but rabies these days, as I say, is because there's not a high suspicion when you're bitten by bats due to lack of community awareness. So recently we've had mainly bats, one case of raccoon, and 12 cases from dog or coyote origin. But of those, wow, I don't know, I didn't do a thing. Of those, 11 of them were acquired outside the US. So it's very rare to get dog-acquired rabies in this country. And as I say, that's mainly because if a dog bites, people are aware that they need to get something done about it. This was a course of about 6 weeks of, I did this a couple of years ago, but it would be the same if I did it this year. This is a course of about 6 weeks of press releases by DHEC in South Carolina. So this is the South Carolina DHEC, of warning people about rabid animals and that they need to be careful, and if they've contacted this particular rabid animal, it's a problem. And in fact, I put some slides at the end of this presentation. There was a case that involved a local softball tournament where a lot of children were exposed to a kitten who turned out to be rabid, and it was taken to the vet because it was sick, and the vet put it to sleep, and nobody thought rabies until somebody happened to think of it, one of the mothers, and she called up the veterinarian and said, "Have you got that kitten?" And he said, "Yeah, it's due to be cremated in a couple of days." And she said, "I'll collect it and take it to DHEC." And it was rabid, and we had a lot of vaccinations as a result of that. So you have to be very careful about this. So they're constantly, whenever there's one of these events, CDC is putting it out. Here, somebody bitten by a cat, somebody bitten by a fox, somebody bitten by a fox. So it goes on and on. So this is just constant stream out from DHEC. So per year, about 40,000 people in this country are treated for possible rabies exposure, and in this state about 400 are, which is why I say, you know, there's a finite chance that you may have to treat somebody for rabies. If you suspect rabies, you contact DHEC, and then they come in and you take case histories, you discuss the danger versus the benefits, and decide whether you want to recommend rabies vaccination. If you do, obviously the person has to be counselled to see whether they're prepared to take it. But given the nature of the beast, virtually everybody will take it if they are at serious risk. What you have is a sort of a grey area, and the question is how far you go into grey area. One of the reasons why you're questioning this is this country spends about $300 million a year on rabies prevention. And this vaccine costs $1,000 per course. So this state is spending almost $500,000 on just vaccinating people. That doesn't include the cost of the public health response and going out and investigating and doing all the lab work and everything else. That's just the cost of vaccinating the people. So it's a big cost. But, you know, people see a dead animal and they take, particularly bats, They take it in for show and tell. You know, it's Halloween and we've got this dead bat in the yard. Wouldn't it be cool to take it into school and all the little kids are looking at it? And then you have to have a post-exposure vaccination campaign. We have one of those this year. Because of that, it's difficult. So what's the major terrestrial, ignoring the bats, sources of rabies? On this coast, it's mainly raccoons. But of course, raccoons can infect other animals, which we can then meet. But most of it is a raccoon variant that's really hanging out in the raccoon population. And unfortunately, it was originally from some introduced raccoons for hunting, and it's spread all over the coast. It's the mongoose down in Puerto Rico. We have several skunk populations. The reason these are in different colours is this population is being infected by a different variant of rabies than this one. But we're protected against all those variants. But the point is, if you do nucleic acid sequencing, you can detect the difference between the variants that's infecting raccoons, the variants that's infecting these skunks, the variant that's infecting these skunks, the variants that infect bats. That means that if you can't take a clinical history from somebody, you can look at which variant they have and determine the likely origin of their rabies. Because one of the problems is, by the time you realise somebody's got rabies, they may well be beyond the stage where you can take a decent clinical history. The family may be aware, but they may not be. But that's another part. You know, CDC has to do all this tracking down to try and work out what happened. There is a false story that rodents cannot be infected. That's not true. Rodents can be infected. They're rarely infected. The small rodents are rarely infected, but it's not impossible. But the larger rodents can be, and in this part of the country, woodchucks, groundhogs, whistling pigs, whatever you want to call them. You see them up in the mountains, and they look really cute, and they sit up and so on. But they will always run away from you. But if a woodchuck ever runs towards you, leave it alone. But they are cute. But as I say, most cases of human rabies are bat-associated. But I don't want to give bats too bad a name. But the point is, if somebody sees a bird in the garden fly into a tree, knock itself out and fall to the ground, their immediate conclusion will be, that's a sick bird. But for some reason, if they see a bat fly by day, fly into a tree, knock itself out and fall to the ground, they'll say, poor bat, because they're sort of convinced that if you don't have good eyesight and you're using sonar, you're likely to, they don't believe that bats can really fly that well, type of thing. The point is, if you see a bat flying by day, that's bad news, because they should be twilight, nighttime animals. If you see a bat fly into a tree, that's also bad news, because that's not, unless it's text messaging, it's not a sensible thing for it to do. The other thing is that frequently people will pick these up. I mean, I've seen people from auxiliary services pick up bats that they find dead or dying inside the school. You know, they roost in the roof and then they fall. But you never know. So, you know, use thick gloves, take good care. If the animal is alive, be extraordinarily careful because, as I say, it could bite you. So people find bats in the houses, they try and catch them, they get scratched. And as I say, these are very small wounds. They might not even tell their relatives. The case of the girl who survived and didn't get any kind of treatment until too late, what happened there was a bat flew into a church window. She very kindly got it out of the church so that it could be left free. And then she got a little scratch and they cleaned it up with peroxide and it didn't do the trick. So you need to be very careful with bats. So what about human-to-human rabies? People are always sort of concerned about this. Surgically, via transplants, that can happen and does happen. And we keep on hoping that taking better clinical histories and more careful backgrounds on the patients will sort it out. But inevitably, if somebody's got rabies and hasn't yet presented with any symptoms, which is what's happened in that case presentation I gave you before, they died apparently of something entirely different before they could actually show the symptoms. Then inevitably you'll occasionally get a case. It should be extraordinarily rare in this country because you hope any infection is extraordinarily rare. But no, despite all this stuff about this virus and the saliva and one thing and another, no human-to-human rabies transmission has ever been thoroughly documented. Now, that doesn't mean it doesn't occur, because obviously a lot of rabies occurs in third world situations where they probably don't have barrier nursing and where people don't go taken to hospital, because people realise it's rabies. They know there's nothing that can be done and they can't afford the hospital type of thing. But no, there's been no well-documented case of this. So, but you still use barrier nursing and you're very careful with any rabid patient, which is part of the reason why we don't see it. Okay, so what about this business about post-exposure prophylaxis? Well, what do you do? First of all, you clean the wound. Remember, this is a bite from an animal. You're going to want to clean the wound anyway. I mean, it's got to be dealt with as a regular wound for a start. But you clean the water with soap and water, or if available, with a virucidal agent. Now, you don't normally have virucidal agents in your, if you're out in the country and being mauled. But the point is, use plenty of clean liquid to try and flush it out. Use plenty of detergent or alcohol-containing liquid to try and inactivate any virus you don't flush out. So, you know, if you've got the bourbon or whatever there, use that. But it's sheer physical removing of the virus, and then it's inactivating of the virus. Because if you can stop it before it gets into cells, you've got a good chance of preventing it. Not that you're ever going to rely on this, but it's better safe than sorry. So you clean the wound, and then you immediately, and that's an emergency situation, you want to get that cleaned as quickly as possible, and then you go to see a physician, and the physician will contact the state health department, determine the risk, and if the animal is available, the animal will be examined. If you want to look this up, I've given you the references for that, but basically they try and capture the animal, or if you've been able to capture the animal, if you've kept the animal, or if it's a domestic animal, they will observe it. If it's been vaccinated, if it's not been vaccinated, they'll kill it in order to be able to do the brain biopsy. Well, it's not a biopsy by then, the brain deadopsy. And then between that, they'll determine about the vaccine. Now, the vaccine, we have two vaccines available. They're both very good. They're both intramuscular. The old story about being vaccinated in the stomach and the endless pain and problems and side effects, that's gone. That vaccine is not been available for 25, 30 years. So the current vaccines are much better, much fewer side effects, fewer doses, and so it's not such a serious deal, but there are inevitably side effects. Any vaccine can have side effects in a certain number of people, but the side effects are nothing like rabies. So, now, what you also do is not only do you give the vaccine to try and raise the antibodies, you also want to try and decrease that virus as much as possible. And you've already done your soap and water and antiviricidal reagents and everything. But what you will do is you can get human rabies immune globulin. So this is serum globulin from people who have had the vaccination as a prophylaxis, not post-exposure, but pre-exposure prophylaxis, because they're at high risk for getting rabies anyway. And that, I will go into the list of that, but obviously veterinarians are somebody that a rabid animal may well be taken to, and veterinarians are routinely vaccinated for rabies. And their titers are monitored, so if you get donors who will give serum in order to have this high human rabies immune globulin. So it's from people with high titers. And what you do is you infiltrate as much of the recommended dose around the wound as possible, because what you want to do is stop that virus, neutralize that virus so it doesn't start an infection. There's no point in giving it intravenously or anything like that. You want to give it around the wound. If you've got any spare and you can't get it all infiltrated around the wound, then you'll give it as an IM injection. But not close to the vaccination site, obviously, because you don't want to neutralize the vaccine. And also, you won't give it, obviously, with the same needle. Standard obvious things. I just am supposed to point them out. So that's important as well. So if you have been, let me just say, if for pre-exposure prophylaxis, veterinarians and their staff, wildlife officers, travellers to countries where there's a lot of canine rabies, and rabies research workers. They're some of the obvious people who are at high risk. People who go into undeveloped caves where there are large colonies of bats as a routine thing. So people who go into these caves on a very regular basis may also be candidates for vaccination. If you've had pre-exposure prophylaxis, you will still need to be vaccinated if you're bitten. But you don't need to take as many doses of the vaccine and you don't need the immune globulin. So that's because you're going to have a memory response. So as soon as you get your new vaccine, you're going to respond very quickly. So the pre-exposure people don't have to have that HRIG, but they do have to have post-exposure vaccination. You always give a booster so that you can make sure they're protected. But if you're not being vaccinated and you're somewhere where you can get the vaccine but you can't get the HRIG, then the recommendation is leave wherever you are to somewhere where you can get the HRIG, because that is something that really is an important part of the post-exposure vaccination for people who are previously unvaccinated. So that's where all the emphasis is, because that's where you can do something. Once the person shows symptoms, the treatment is virtually always unsuccessful. And it's very sad because there are all these thousands and thousands, tens of thousands of cases a year, every year, for years and years. And as I say, just one person who didn't get some kind of prophylaxis has survived, and possibly two. And even if people have got some people who didn't receive the full course and were bitten, they managed to recover after symptoms. But if that's the problem, even if you've been partially vaccinated or something, didn't have the HRIG or something, but there are five people who recovered from rabies, and those five had some kind of help. So it's really very, very tough. So that's part of the reason, as I say, why you have to revaccinate anybody who's been previously vaccinated. Just relying on something below the recommendations can be very dangerous. And so this is a case, and I think I've got time just to sort of briefly go over it. There was rabies due to organ transplants. The donor died of a brain hemorrhage, so it wasn't realised that the donor had rabies. They didn't die of any kind of dementia. But then three organ transplants from the same donor came down with a kind of encephalitis. And they didn't realise what it was, but after these people died, the pathologist saw intracytoplasmic inclusions. That immediately raises your suspicion that this is probably an RNA virus, suggestive of rabies. So I guess they look like Negri bodies. In neurons, in multiple areas of the brain, right place. They sequenced this, and it looked like it was a rabies variant associated with bats. And apparently, later when they questioned the family, he had been reported being bitten by a bat but hadn't sought medical attention for it. They found another case, which wasn't an organ transplant. Part of the artery had been used in surgical procedure, and that patient also died. So four people died from this. And then, of course, what they have to do is what they always have to do when anybody gets rabies. They have to go and determine all the contacts of the person who gets rabies in order to determine whether or not they need vaccinations or not. Because the attitude here is this is so nasty that it's never too late. You know, if this is going to be an 18-month incubation, even if it's a year after the event, you'll still go and offer vaccination. So it's, as I say, it's a very serious thing. But the problem is, the longer it is until you realise what's going on, the more patients you have with it in this particular case, and the more contacts you have with these patients, and so you have to go back and vaccinate these people. The number of people who have to be vaccinated continually grows until you realise what you've got and start closing in on it. Same thing if you have a rabid animal, you have to go and do large investigations as to how many kids at this school handled this animal. There was a kindergarten class that was taken to a pet shop in order to have a fun morning, and it turned out one of the animals that they were all handling was rabid. There was a case in New Hampshire where they had to vaccinate 600 people who had contact with a rabid animal. So it can be, but you can imagine the amount of tracking down and contact and the number of people it takes to do all that. All of that adds to the cost and containment of rabies. So what you'll see is very strong, rapid response to try and contain it, make sure nobody's at risk, reduce the costs. So any questions on rabies? That's the biggie of these, okay? Let's go on now. So we're talking about animal to human, direct or not via an insect vector at least. And the next group I'm going to talk about are ones that we get from rodents. And there's two RNA virus families here that are involved. Both of them are enveloped, both of them are helical, both have segmented genomes. And I'm not going to make a big fuss of it, but I've seen sometimes questions that do. So I'm just going to tell you that the arena virus family is so-called ambisense. You've had negative sense RNA viruses, where what goes in is complementary to message. You've had positive sense viruses, where what goes in functions as message. It turns out we also have a few viruses that are ambisense RNA viruses, in which part of the genome functions as message and the other part has to be copied into a complement and then functions as message. So you get every variant that can be, and it so happens these arena viruses are ambisense. The important thing is they're enveloped. So again, like rabies, they're going to be relatively easy to inactivate if you know what you're dealing with and how to deal with it. So common features of both of these families is that the route of infection is predominantly via urine. It can be other rodent droppings, but predominantly urine. And what happens is the little mice or other rodents meander around, and they do what mice do as they meander around. And then somebody comes and sweeps or moves this around in some way or other, creates dust aerosol, and then breathes it into their lungs and gets the disease. So this is why I say, if you go on to CDC and look up these creatures, these viruses, you'll find a lot of household advice as to how to do your housework if you've got mice around. Because the idea is you don't want to go brushing stuff and get it and breathing it. What you want to do is you want to put appropriate disinfectants on top of this stuff and then clean it up and then dispose of it properly. It will be inactivated by the detergents. But you don't want to go sweeping the droppings without inactivating them first. So the route is via the respiratory tract. Now, there are hundreds of these things, and they have names which may be cute, but you're not going to want to remember them all. Don't worry with the names of the virus here. Don't worry with these at all. The Lassa fever is one that you need to be aware of because it's a very nasty thing, and periodically we can get imported cases, and certainly if you're going to Africa for any reason, that's something that if you're practicing in Africa in certain areas that you will meet. There are a lot of these hemorrhagic fevers in South America as well, normally just named after the country where they were first isolated. So we got Brazilian, Bolivian, Argentine, Venezuelan. There was a virus that caused the death of 3 people a few years ago in California, and as far as I can find, we haven't seen any cases of it since, but I have put it there. But Again, I'm not going to ask you questions on these, but you do need to be aware that these hemorrhagic fever viruses are common in various locales in South America, and there are a few even in this country. And then the other one that is widespread in this country is lymphocytic chorioamnionitis, and I'm going to call that LCM or LCMV. And that's widespread. It causes relatively minor disease, but it can be more serious. So these hemorrhagic fevers have got the same sort of thing that we discussed with dengue hemorrhagic fever: dehydration, hemoconcentration because you get leaky blood vessels, hemorrhage, shock, cardiovascular collapse, and the case fatality rate according to these different viruses can be between 5 and 35%. Lassa fever clinical cases have got a fairly high case fatality rate. Very nasty diseases. You get a lot of bleeding, and the patient tends to hate to be touched with these hemorrhagic fevers because it's so painful. So it's really a nasty disease. The answer is, if it's an arena virus, you immediately suspect rodents and you immediately deal with the rodent population. The one that we see more often in this country is LCMV, and in fact a lot of people have seroconverted for LCMV without ever being aware they've had the disease. About 5% of wild mice are infected, and they don't have any obvious signs of the disease, which is what we often see with these zoonoses. They don't seem to have much effect on their natural host. It's us, their unnatural host, that we have more problems with. Rabies is not like that. Rabies has an effect on all the animals it affects, and it can infect virtually any mammal. But arena viruses, you can also get them from pet rodents such as hamsters. And there have been several cases of people getting LCMV from hamsters. Part of the reason there, I think, is you probably get into more close contact with hamsters than you do with wild mice. The cases are often subclinical. If you do get a clinical case, it's usually, again, flu-like symptoms, plus you might get some nausea and vomiting. But it can go to the brain, and you can get meningitis and encephalitis or myelitis. People usually recover without problems, but sometimes there can be some problems. But where the problem lies here is it can be a problem for the fetus, particularly in the first and second trimester. So this is yet another reason, we had it for toxo, for not cleaning out animal cages and cat boxes and one thing and another. So if you're pregnant, give all these jobs to somebody else in the household. It's also been associated with deaths in transplant recipients. Again, it looks as if it's a virus that our immune system normally handles pretty well, and we don't have too much of a problem with it. But if you've got a fetus or a transplant situation, it can be a problem. And if you want more details about it, I put a little thing from CDC in the handout notes. Are there any questions on the arena viruses? So worldwide, they're mainly associated with hemorrhagic fevers. But as I say, in this country, the one that we see most is associated with meningitis, encephalitis as the serious consequences. So the next couple of viruses I want to talk about are hantaviruses. Again, these are rodent vectors against their segmented RNA. Envelope viruses. So again and again, they're transmitted by the respiratory route. And again, you inactivate the droppings before you clean them up. Bleach will also work, but you use plenty of it. So these typically caused hemorrhagic fevers with a renal component. So there were renal symptoms, renal damage, as well as these hemorrhagic fevers. And they were seen worldwide, but the worst one was the one that occurs in Southeast Asia. It's got the higher case fatality rate. So this was particularly, as far as this country is concerned, it was particularly a problem for troops in Southeast Asia because quite a few people came down with this. And transmitted by rodents. In this country, there was a outbreak, well, it's getting quite a long time ago now, but seems recent to me, of a pulmonary syndrome, which was acute respiratory distress, very high case fatality rates. They didn't know what it was, flu-like symptoms initially, and then basically people drown because their lungs fill up with fluid. People thought all sorts of things. And CDC was trying to work out, was it a toxin, was it this, was it that, was it the other? And then when they actually managed to find out what the virus was, they discovered that to their surprise, it was a hantavirus. Now, hantavirus is a part of the bunyavirus family. Most bunyaviruses, we've talked about La Crosse, but there are many, many bunyaviruses. Most of them are transmitted by insects. The hantavirus is a genus that is transmitted by rodents. And they found out that this was actually a hantavirus, which was not expected because you don't normally associate this pulmonary syndrome with hantaviruses. They're associated with hemorrhagic fever and renal syndrome. But immediately they saw it was a hantavirus. Their suspicion was this is rodent-borne because all the other hantaviruses we knew about were rodent-borne. And so they immediately looked at the rodents, and sure enough, they find that there were rodents, whereupon they tell you how to do your housework, and also how to do your work on the farm and the garden where you got anything that's mouse-infected or rodent-infected. It was something called Peromyscus that was the original one that they found. But it turns out we've got lots of rodent populations over the states that are carrying different members of this subgroup of hantavirus pulmonary syndrome viruses. So the Korean hemorrhagic fever has a case fatality rate of about 7%. And as I say, there are a lot of other similar viruses around the world. They usually have a lower case fatality rate. Hantavirus pulmonary syndrome has a case fatality rate of about 36%. And in different parts of the country, different relatives are being carried by different rodents. Because one feature about these viruses is they do tend to be adapted to a particular rodent. So we said with a lot of these arboviruses, they're adapted to a particular mosquito. With a lot of these rodent-borne viruses, they're adapted to a particular rodent. So they're not non-specific. They like their own favourite rodent. And I've said the pulmonary syndrome, which has got a case fatality rate of about 35%, which is really nasty, is various members of the family. I've named one of them here, Synnombre, and the reason I've named it, there's all sorts of these now. We've got, 10 or so in this country, more in South America. But I've named Synnombre because, again, sometimes in the books they ask you about Synnombre. It's one of the ones around here. It was the first one discovered, and it does cause a lot in the southwest. But it's all over the country. To avoid South Carolina for some reason. Again, standard types of symptoms, fever, myalgia, nausea, vomiting, cough. This is going for the respiratory tract. And then eventually shortness of breath and severe. Here's the radiographic progression. May the 27th, 3 days later, look at the level of fluid in the lungs. It's horrendous. Any questions on that? I just want to briefly mention two viruses. Hemorrhagic fever that cause hemorrhagic fevers, severe. Massive amounts of virus in the blood. Very infectious. Barrier nursing is necessary, which is why these people are wearing hoods, masks, gowns, gloves. You can't see what's on their feet, but those are protected as well. Because the blood is everywhere, because these people are bleeding out of every orifice and their skin it's terrible. They're called filoviruses because they're very long and thin and they're basically rhabdoviruses on steroids. So they're helical, shrink-wrapped, but very long. So they have these long things, they twist into various shapes. They look like worms, but of course they're the size of viruses. They have a very high case fatality rate, 60 to 90%. They occur in Africa. We don't know the natural reservoir, but we think it may be bats. You can see it in other primates, but we think that's, again, not their natural host. You get a very high viremia, so you need to be very careful about them. And also, the problem is, of course, also that you have to be careful about funeral practices, because in many of these places, it's traditional for the family to come and see the body and clean it and wrap it up and things, and you can't allow that kind of thing because the body is so infectious. So it's really a major problem when you get it. And we get some big outbreaks periodically, despite the fact that various health organisations worldwide will immediately send as many people as they can to help in these situations. So I just wanted to point out that one of the problems with these zoonoses is we're encroaching on animals in their natural habitat. We're changing our agricultural practices so that these animals are being forced out of the fields and going into local villages because they can no longer find what they wanted in the fields. There's wildlife trade, which is a problem. We've already discussed a few of those cases. There are these exotic foods and live animal markets, bushmeat. They've been causes of various zoonotic outbreaks. Travel, ecotourism, petting zoos, pet shops, petting zoos, exotic pets, all of these can be problems. The other thing I just want to briefly point out is I've been putting all the blame on RNA viruses in these zoonoses because most of the ones we see are. But there are DNA viruses that can cause zoonoses. So I think Dr. Ganjemi may briefly have mentioned there's a herpes B virus that sometimes primates bring into this country and animal handlers have died of getting that. And there's, I mentioned, an outbreak of monkeypox that was brought in by these exotic rats. So we do get DNA viruses as well, but they're much rarer. The vast majority of zoonoses are by RNA viruses. Okay, thank you, and we'll take our 10-minute break here. And I'm sorry, I was thinking it was 10 o'clock, and it's only 9 o'clock. So let's take the 10-minute break, and then we'll come back, and we'll discuss these prion diseases in the next lecture. Thank you.